I think we have everything that we need to advance ourselves every day. I may not be able to speak the many tongues that's available there, but I am African to the core, and I celebrate that. And as I celebrate those of us in the diaspora that has accomplished, I cannot celebrate any of us without celebrating Africa. I cannot celebrate the accomplishments of today without celebrating the accomplishments of yesterday. Because none of us, we're interdependent. None of us has accomplished anything on our own. Everything interconnects. You have to know where you come from. You have to know yourself. You have to love yourself. And I think that should be our focus. That should be the focus for us to be aware of our history, our culture, and how we can use it today to advance ourselves as a people.
We started this bookstore approximately 25 years ago. And they, what we would say, are pioneers in promoting African literature and African-centered literature in this country. And along with a woman by the name of Dr. Rita Cox, who started a collection of Black and Caribbean collection at the Parkdale Library that existed for many years. And these two institutions, the Black and Caribbean collection at the Toronto Public Library and Third World Books, were the places where black folks could feel that validated and they would have the opportunity to access books that speak to them. And just as importantly, the wider population could access books that speak to the black experience, right? And it's out of this that we started getting a number of authors that cut their teeth in the journalistic world, in the world of writing poetry, in the world of writing novels, and the world of writing serious nonfiction. So we have to pay credit, and we stand on the shoulders of those two institutions that have been the basis for developing and promoting black literature in this country. All bookstores tend to become cultural centers because they represent so many aspects of in the books that they carry, so many aspects of a people's experience and knowledge, you know, and people gravitate to bookstores in order to learn, to experience, to share, and to have a cultural experience. As the bookstore developed over the years, we became very involved in cultural activities besides selling books. And as many people know, we were across the street from our present address in the Movish Village. That's where we were for over 20 years. And then we had to move because of Movish Village was taken over by a new development. And so in moving across the street, we decided that it was an opportunity to have an actual cultural center to start separate from the bookstore. So we started a nonprofit organization called A Different Bookless Cultural Center, and that is now existing in this space as a separate entity and promoting a number of cultural programs, a number of cultural activities. And my wife, Aita Sadu, she is the managing director of that of the center. And right now, is because of the COVID situation, is mainly operating online through webinars and Zooms, but it's a continuation of what the bookstore has been over the years. I know a number of people have asked us about our experience during COVID, and we want to say that it's been an up and down experience. Of course, we've had to go online. We have had to close the store since March, and that has been the reality of the situation. But after the murder of George Floyd by the police, and after the resultant protests by Black Lives Matter movement and others, we began receiving a surge of orders online from people seeking books dealing with racism, dealing with white superiority, dealing with issues of equity. And it was an overwhelming experience because we weren't, it was unexpected, and also we weren't physically prepared to handle so much. So we had to take a while before we could adjust to that situation. But it was interesting because of that someone had to die in that horrible manner in order for people to wake up and realize the kind of deep-seated racism that exists in the society and the kind of entrenched racism at the top. Every exposure to the truth is always a good thing, so, and we are glad that people are now educating themselves on these issues. We have definitely benefited for it, and we have to thank the Black Lives Movement for bringing that to people's attention and to encouraging people to buy books from black bookstores. So that has been our experience during the COVID, and we continue to look forward to promoting our literature and to promoting black authors. We do a number of interviews with black authors online, the Cultural Center in particular. And my wife, Aita, has been carrying on these interviews with new books. We have one coming up with Cesar Chavannes, who was a former member of the parliament, the Liberal Party, and many other books we are going to be showcasing for Black History Month. But we thank you for this opportunity to promote the bookstore, to represent the work that we've been doing, and to encourage people out there to support the bookstore, support the center in particular, because the center is going to be where many programs and many events will take place that will speak to youth, speak to seniors, speak to all levels of our community and all aspects of our community. And we actually have a campaign going on right now, because we're going to be moving into a new location in a new development with the support of the city. We have earmarked a building for us to move into, but we need support in terms of the infrastructure. And so we've started a campaign called the Buy a Brick campaign, which will raise money, or intended to raise money for that purpose. So encourage you to be in touch with us, to learn more about the campaign, to walk side by side with us to build a better community, a more vital community, and to promote our literature in every way possible. Thank you.
We are pleased to unveil two commemorative collection pieces, the 2021 Canada Post Black History Month stamps and a Royal Canadian Mint coin that recognizes Black history. Download today's electronic program book located on our website for details on today's lineup, as well as information on our Black History Month programs during February that includes a phenomenal speaker series, as well as resources that we have to share with the public. We are so excited to host some young, talented local performers. You have the pleasure of experiencing musical performances from Nicole Chambers and Bolu Sings. Music is always a comforting and uplifting addition to our annual program.
Hello everyone, my name is Bolu Sings and I'm a 13-year-old singer-songwriter. Today I'll be singing a song I wrote called Make It Right, which I wrote in 2020. Although I wrote this song in 2020, I do strongly believe that this message is still relevant today. Before I start, I would like to say a huge thanks to the Ontario Black History Society for having me here today. This organization continues to educate and empower Canadians on Black history, which is very crucial and important to our youth today. I'm very thankful for this society, and I know that together we can make it right. Without any further ado, this is my song, Make It Right. Thank you.
My name is Liz Wong, Stamp Design Manager with Canada Post. Canada Post is proud to be one of our country's storytellers. Avec notre programme des timbres postes, on a le privilège de raconter les histoires des personnes, des événements et des réalisations qui font du Canada un pays exceptionnel. C'est aussi une occasion de refléter la diversité et le caractère inclusif du Canada. Aujourd'hui, j'ai l'honneur de dévoiler la 13e émission de notre série de timbres consacrés au mois de l'histoire des Noirs. This year, we are paying tribute to the brave pioneers who overcame harrowing conditions to settle two historic communities in Canada. Escaping slavery after the War of 1812, a wave of American refugees fled to New Brunswick and established the small community of Willow Grove in 1817. Près d'un siècle plus tard, vers 1910, des immigrants fuyant l'oppression dans le sud des États-Unis fondent la communauté de Amber Valley dans le nord de l'Alberta. Both groups faced harsh climates, unforgiving land that was difficult to farm, and continued racism. But they persevered and for a time created thriving free communities. Their descendants live on across Canada today. It is my pleasure to unveil our Black History Month stamps for 2021.
Honored to speak to you on behalf of the Royal Canadian Mint as we join Canadians in celebrating Black History Month. C'est un honneur pour moi de m'adresser à vous aujourd'hui au nom de tous les employés de la Monnaie Royale Canadienne. The Mint prides itself in crafting coins that honor Canada's history, culture, and values. We are so proud to be issuing our third coin marking Black History Month. Krista Bruce, the product manager who developed this coin featuring the armorial bearings of the Black Loyalist, has a personal connection to the project. Krista was born and raised in Nova Scotia, is a descendant of Black Loyalists. It is my pleasure and privilege to introduce you to Krista.
I am deeply honored to have had the opportunity to have led the creation of the 2021 coin commemorating Black history and telling the story of my ancestors, the Black Loyalists. I am proud to share their story of triumph and courage, and I respect and appreciate their role in fighting for the rights and liberties of Black Canadians. Their achievements and their struggles are an important part of Canada's story and its journey towards greater acceptance and inclusion for all. Thank you to the Black Loyalist Heritage Society for allowing us to use their armorial bearings so that we could share the story of the Black Loyalists with our fellow Canadians.
Today, we spotlight the personal histories of four of our board members to represent different journeys and experiences in the African diaspora. Our first Vice President, Shannon Oyunerin, Treasurer, Dorothy Abbott, and Linda Carter and Dwayne Genus, both members at large. They graciously share their family genealogies and heritages.
Hi, I'm Shannon Oyunerin.
I'm Solomon Oluwaseun Oyunerin.
And we are so happy to be here to talk to you about the Ontario Black History Society theme this year, History, Who We Are. Now, I just want to talk a bit about my family history. I'm Canadian born, but Jamaican heritage, and I'm married to my Nigerian husband. We'll talk a bit more about that later. But with my history, my family has done a lot of research, especially my mom, who spoke to my great-grandmother, who passed away in 2007. She spoke to her at length about our family history. And one of the proud things about our history is that we are descendants of the Maroons. So while my mom did all her research and I took up the research of our family history, I was able to discover that the last name Brown is very important to Maroon heritage. So my granny, Isola Isadora Ivy, her mother, her name was Elfrida Cleopatra Brown. So when I visited Jamaica in July 2018, I visited Charlestown Maroon Settlement, went to the museum, and was so happy and surprised to see Brown listed as a name that people of Maroon descent have. So that was so nice to see that. When I got back to Canada a week later, I quickly ordered an ancestry DNA kit to see if, you know, where I'm coming from. My granny had always told my mom that we were, in fact, what she was told, from the Ivory Coast. However, I'm a historian, and just knowing Nigeria was at the top. So my lovely husband here was very happy about that. I'm still doing research now to see if that's the case, but I know he would love for it to be Nigeria. So still on that journey to find out where my ancestors were taken from in West Africa. But yes, I know he would like it to be Nigeria.
Do you want
to
talk about how we actually met and then take
yes.
it back to Nigeria?
So we met in the United Kingdom in 2010 doing our master's degree. He was doing business and economics,
yeah.
and I was doing slavery studies. And yeah, we met at church and just got to talking, and he figured, you know, learned about my degree and what I was, my background. I remember asking you,
mm-hmm.
like, do you know about slavery and were you guys taught that in school? And your answer was...
No, I think that was actually quite fascinating because when I met her, she was talking about Black history, slavery, and all of this. I was like, yeah, we knew about colonialism and all these things, but it wasn't as deep as you finished to come to University of Hull, which wasn't really that a remarkable university in the UK, right? But it was a place for, renowned for history, particularly being, Abraham, what's the name again? William Wilberforce's house, right? That was actually where she had a lecture. So moving from there, it challenged me personally to learn more about what my source was, what happened to these people and that were stolen and enslaved from Africa and beginning to connect back along the line. And she actually did something that was also funny during that period. She knew about the Badagry Slavery Museum just right behind me in Lagos, and I didn't even know about it. She found that out and actually traveled to Nigeria so she can actually visit that museum. I actually drove out there and I was looking at everywhere, like all the movies right behind my house. And so that kind of really showed the kind of gap in knowledge about slavery and things that actually occurred within that moment. But fast forward now, I think it's really important for Africans, for Canadians, for Jamaicans, from all over the world. As far as we are concerned, the people of color, we have a source, we have a history. And this is really important as we learn about history, who we are, to connect with one another, to build organic solidarity within our community, and to really to go back to the roots that somebody from the Caribbean can have an identity back in a place like Nigeria or Africa. And somebody from Africa can also connect with those in America, you know, and all of us having this connection and understanding our roots ultimately. When the time of the logo started, I've actually been, since I got so much involved with the Ontario Records Society, channel volunteering with them, and then later becoming a part of the board, it started occurring to me that we needed to refresh the whole brand and the brand representation of the organization. And then I went through the logo and I did a few, you know, redrawing, and because I do graphics anyways. So I looked at a few concepts and ideas we could propose, and this was like maybe 3 or 4 years ago. But after going through everything, I realized then that the organization was actually not ready for a whole logo. But for some reasons, this year, 2 months ago, we started to think about rebranding the organization. And what was so funny, they gave out a few samples to some other people to do. And for some reason, I didn't want to get involved. But Shannon was going through these samples, but I was like, nah, this is no BTC for BTS. So I just went in my curl drawer, scratched everything, and we came up with a new logo. So from 1978 to 2020, when we actually did the new logo, there's a bit of a similarity, but a few contrasts as well. But one thing that was really key in this new logo, from the last logo, was the books were closed in the old logo. But now, history is alive and living, and we need to pass across this knowledge to other people. And that was what was in my mind as we're designing this logo, such that we have the book open now so that people can begin to live the knowledge, live the history, and live the legacy that our ancestors have passed across to us.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Dorothy Abbott, and I'm a director with the Ontario Black History Society. I would like to share some of my family's genealogy with you, which dates back over 170 years in Canada, primarily in Grey County and then into the Toronto area. I have been working on my genealogy for a number of years, have done some road trips down to places like Murfreesboro, Tennessee, where we were able to trace a great-great-grandfather who had been a slave on a plantation and escaped when he was about 29 years of age north and ultimately to Canada around 1850. My grandmother on my mother's side, her parents were William and Lucy Morton, and she had three siblings, James, Richard, and Elizabeth Morton. There are pictures that are passing through in the background that will give you examples of how they looked back then and their lives and the surroundings. As I said, we have six and seven generations. There are only six generations showing on the quilt because the last generation was not born yet, my grandson and my sister's grandsons. My grandmother was Hannah Jane Morton. There is a very distinctive picture of her on the quilt at age 75, and at that point I was only 3 years of age. She celebrated her 100th birthday and lived almost to her 101st birthday. She had two marriages, first to Albert Scott, where she had two children, Josephine and Morton Scott, and they had fairly large families, creating many cousins right to this generation. My grandmother unfortunately lost her first husband, became a widow at a very young age, and ultimately remarried and had a second family of two children, Douglas and Valair Smith. So she had two families, and in her second family, her youngest daughter, Valair Smith, was my mother. Valair also went on to marry and unfortunately lost her husband at a very early age, my father. I was only 16 months old at that time. And she remarried and had two more children. She has had a career in music for many years in Ontario, and three of her children went into the music business as well, following in her footsteps. I think it's important that we all check our genealogy, follow our roots, because if you don't know where you've come from, how can you know where you are going? And I'd like to take a couple of minutes now to introduce you to a few historical monuments up in the Grey County. The first one is at the Sheffield Museum, and it consists of two giant boulders which have the names of the mariners who worked the lake boats many years ago, and many members of my family and other settlers from Owen Sound are listed on that. The other rock talks about settler families. And then in Owen Sound itself, in Harrison Park, there is a memorial cairn which has been there since 2004 and was created by Benita Johnson de Matthias, who is part of one of the descendant families. The cairn has been used to celebrate many different things, including Black Lives Matter last summer, Emancipation Day, people grieving when they were disturbed about things, but happier times like family celebrations and announcements. I have also had the opportunity to participate in a North is Freedom exhibit named for a poem by George Eliot Clarke. It opened in 2016 in Washington, D.C., at the same time as the African American Museum. There's been many opportunities for me as a member of the OBHS. I've led tours, to Washington and Nova Scotia, participated in Africville, and I encourage you all to get out there, study your genealogy, and mark it down. Let us know what your family history is. Let your family know so you can celebrate together. Thank you.
So I did a lot of modeling. I have a book here that I've been working on with a number of different photographs and actually kind of like my journey as far as a fashion, as far as a fashion person. This is one of my first ones. Remember this? This must have been sometimes in the early 70s, late 60s. Fashion. Fashion has evolved so much. This here is my first printed. This is my first print. I think it came out, I forget what magazine. It might have been Spear. Some of you remember that. So there's a lot of fashion, a lot of history. And I also loved listening to the stories of my parents, of my father, when he would talk about what it was like growing up in this city as a Black person. And I know what he went through, and there's a lot of things that I know as being a Black Canadian, what I had to go through, being the only one almost ever in school, from primary school right up to college. This is where it all started. The baby pictures. And right now, I really want to encourage people. I want to encourage people, particularly young people, to talk to their grandparents, because they hold the history. And once they're gone forever. And all of the history and all of the stories that they had are gone. So that's the only way to really know your history, is to talk to the people who have lived the history, which is your lineage. So I find now that my grandmother is gone, and there's so many questions that I wanted to talk to her about. Like, you came from St. Kitts. What was that like? What was your father? What was your mother like? I mean, we know that we've all come from the transatlantic slaves, that we're all here for because of that. But who's our family? How did we get here? I wish I had been able to talk to my grandmother to find out more about her mother, to more about her father. One thing that I did learn, but I didn't learn this until after my grandfather passed in St. Kitts. And I asked my mother, you know, to tell me a bit about him. And I asked her, well, why do we have, like, we would have, like, bright red streaks in our hair? And I asked her, well, why do we have these bright red streaks? And she said, oh, it's because of that Englishman. And I said, what Englishman? What are you talking about? She says, you know that Englishman. Okay. The Englishman that wrote that hymn. What hymn are we talking about? She says, you know that story, you know that hymn, Amazing Grace? I said, what are you talking about? I find out that my grandfather, who had just passed, was, not even sure how many greats it is, maybe three greats, great, great, great grandson of John Newton, who wrote Amazing Grace. So I did a documentary on my father, Judge George E. Carter. He wasn't a judge. Well, he wasn't always a judge. He was just George at the time, or Dad. And I did this story on him because I wanted to find out what it was like for him as a Black man growing up in this city to become the person that he was. So hence, I did a documentary on him, and it took me a long time to do it. And I must say that he was the hardest person to photograph. It took me like maybe five times to finally sit down and talk to Dad. I'm really glad that I was able to do that, because there's so many stories that came out of Dad's stories. The story of the Blacks and the Jews, the stories of him growing up in what they call the Belt, stories of going to Harvard Collegiate, going to university, going to Trinity College, all of these things, so much. And also finding out, as a Black person, how he found his history. He was told to go to the library because that's where the history was. That's where his history was. So he went to the library and he found out about great Africans, that he might have been a minority at Harvard, but he was a majority someplace else, of people that had done some amazing, amazing things and still had their kingdoms. He talked to me about Scipio Africanus. He talked to me about Hannibal and the elephants. But all of those things he found in the library. I'm sitting here and I'm looking at so many different photographs. And right now, since Mom and Dad have both passed, unfortunately, we're in the process of going through the house. And my brothers, my two brothers and my sister and I, and unbelievable, the history that we're finding. And I hope that I can show you some of the history. This is one thing that we found, 365 days of Black history. I found this in a box under the table just the other day, but there's so much history that I hope to be able to share with everyone. I mean, people that I've never heard of, 1510 to 1537, Alessandro de' Medici. I think Beethoven's in here, because by the way, in case you didn't know, he was Black. So there's a lot, there's so much history. They talk about China and about the Africans there, about the black Chinese there. There's so many people. And also, one thing that I know that my mother was very, very proud of, and Dad would talk about when Marcus Garvey came. When Marcus Garvey came, and they were at the AME Church, the African Methodist Church on Soho, which is, of course, gone now. Actually, they tore the church down the week before I went to shoot the documentary. So the AME Church and the UNIA Hall, which was 355 College Street, which was our home for Black people at the time. Even that's, it's the building's still there, but the number's gone. Luckily, I was able to photograph that. But the history, and Dad talked about how the military, how the RCMP were called to, those are the turtles making noise in the background. Sorry about that. They have no manners. They're noisy too. Anyway, how the RCMP were called to be, you know, on call because Blacks were getting together. Marcus Garvey, because he would come with his militia and all of his regalia, and they would stand with their arms. But Mom, they used to have autograph books at that time, and this is Marcus Garvey's autograph. From, I'll have to send you another picture of that. Marcus Garvey, Toronto, July the 23rd, 1937, where he used to live. And he was living at the time, Beaumont Crescent, West Kensington, London. We have Lincoln Alexander, that Dad and Lincoln Alexander, who was our lieutenant governor, and my mother, the three of them grew up together. And they were always at my Aunt Sarah's house at the east end of the city. So there's so much history, but then you could really see our style, Black people's style. And when you look at the pictures, it's like, wow. I remember growing up that when we would go out, my mother would make sure, she said, you better put yourself together properly and particularly fix your hair because we're going around colored people. So we gotta look good. At that time we were colored. I think we became Negroes after that. And then we became Blacks. And now we are who we should be. We're people of African descent. So lots and lots of photographs that I have. So many wonderful stories. I mean, Look, I don't know if you can even see this, but the styles, the photo, oh, this is my first time in Bermuda. Just lots and lots of great pictures. Boxes of pictures. Luckily, some of them even have the years on the back. Oh, there's Linda in a snowsuit. I wanted to talk about this bat. This was, Dad always talked about cricket. I remember when I lived in Jamaica, people would listen to cricket on the radio. Aye, it was like listening to the grass grow. But Dad loved cricket, and he was part of the cricket team here. So this was his bat, his Stuart Surridge bat that was given to him. I forget how it came to him. It was given to him by the mayor of... Anyway, you have to watch the documentary because I talk about it in the documentary. It was one of the last times that I saw him out on the street. He must have been about 85 with the bat. He was a great batsman and he had a great arm. And here is actually a picture of the cricket team. This is Dad and he must have been about 16, 18 years old. As a cricketer, he loved cricket. I never understood cricket. I understand baseball. I do not understand cricket. That's why I had to do the documentary, was just to show the history of our people in this country. And the other thing is, it shouldn't only be February. Black history is Canadian history. Matthew DaCosta, by the way, my grandmother was a DaCosta from St. Kitts. Matthew DaCosta, he spoke the languages. So if he spoke the language, he must have been here before. And that was 16 something. So Black people have been here, have been in history for years. But unfortunately, we haven't written the history because we have griots and we talk about the history, but those that wrote the history have, to put it very bluntly, have whitewashed our history. So now we are rewriting history and you will find that diversity is not just today. Diversity has been happening throughout the ages, throughout the kingdoms. That Black people, that Africa was a very prominent part of the trade routes, that Africa had, and people, Europeans, knew this, and that's why so much was taken out of Africa. The gold, the history. I remember I lived in Paris for quite a while, and I finally went to Notre Dame Cathedral. I went by myself on a Saturday afternoon or something, and I went through on my own, and I looked, and I was stunned. I had never seen so much gold in my life, so much gold behind glass, all these gold and jewels. It's like, wait a minute, where did all this gold come from? I didn't know that France had so much gold. The gold came from Africa. The Gold Coast was a reality, and it's still there, and it's still being plundered. So we have to know our history. And like I said before, Black history is Canadian history, and it's so, so, so important that we pay attention to our heroes and that we honor them. Because you know what? They're in our families. That's part of my story. Hopefully, you'll all tell yours.
So welcome to our home. My name is Duane.
And my name is Uchenwa.
And we're the Genius family. So it is indeed a pleasure to have the opportunity to tell you a little bit about our family. Coincidentally, our youngest son, Arinze, just finished a project talking about his family tree. And so it was a perfect opportunity to coordinate with this project and to tell you about that as well. I was born here, but my father is from Jamaica. My parents actually are from Jamaica, West Indies. My father, Urquhart Genus, is from St. Elizabeth, Carlisle District. And his father's name was Harold Genus, also known as Mass Harry. And his wife, my grandmother, Iceland Genus, they had 10 children. On my mother's side, her name is Jacqueline Downey. And her father's name was Cyril Downey. And and her mother's name is Hortense Walters. And she actually has eight sisters.
And for my side of the family, my father's name was Wabisi Iraga. And he comes from a long line of judges and chiefs in our area. We're from Umukurala Umuaya, which is in Abia State, Nigeria. So my father was a chief of our village. My grandfather, his father was also chief in his time. His name was Iragampa Wajamena, and he was married to my grandmother, Ulu Uche. On my mother's side, her name is Nkechinyere Obona, and she comes from a family that's very enterprising, into business and trading. Her father's name was Obona Woke, and he was married to my grandmother, whose name was Ekalaka Oguru.
So actually, my parents actually came to Canada in the late 70s. And so they were both sponsored by family, told us about the struggles of what it was like coming to Canada for the first time. It was difficult to get jobs. They struggled through and were married in 1972. I was born the year after. And we ended up moving to Pickering. In the early 80s, and so I grew up in Pickering, just a stone's throw from here.
And for my family, my father migrated to Canada on a student scholarship to university in the late 1950s. Later on, he brought my mother and my oldest sister with him just out of the Biafran War. And so we did grow up in North York, Pickering, for instance, are just some of the examples of where we spent our time. Although we did go back to Nigeria for boarding school, my siblings and I took that trip.
So I actually met my beautiful wife December 24th, 1994. I was coming down from university for the Christmas break, and I was shopping in Pickering Town Center, and I saw her working there. And I went in, introduced myself, worked my magic, and here we are years later. So we have
two teenage sons. We've been married for 19 years, I should say first. We have two teenage sons. Our oldest is John David. He's 15 years old, and our youngest is Arinze, and he's 13 years old.
So during that time, we've had the opportunity to do a lot of great and amazing things. One of those things that we were able to do was to write a novel, which is more or less a memoir. It's the true story of my mother-in-law and how she escaped the Biafran War in Nigeria in the late 1960s and came to Canada. So it's a really amazing story. As well, I actually did my ancestry.com and wanted to find out, where actually my roots came from. So got those results and found out that 83% African or 80% African, and majority of my people, they're coming from Togo, Benin, and Nigeria.
And another exciting project that we undertook was starting a math tutoring program called Genius Nation, and we've run that through the summer in partnership with the JCA, the Jamaican Canadian Association, and we're currently running it lab now independently.
So just to kind of close off, one of the, important things my father stressed to us growing up was the importance of reading and learning and knowing your history. And so that has become a passion of mine. I actually love to collect books that talk about Black history. And some of those books are right here on this table. And we have a number of great leaders, but the greatest of all in my eyes is Marcus Garvey. It's the reason I say that is because he was a forerunner for so many people that came after him. And wanted to leave you with this quote here that I think is very fitting. A people without the knowledge of their past, origin, and culture is like a tree without roots. So as a people, I firmly believe that we need to remember this so we can grow. So thanks so much, and have a great time.
Thank you.
There are several existing Black historic sites and memorials that exist across Southern Ontario. Since we missed the opportunity to visit some of these sites last summer due to the lockdown, we're taking you around the province to have a virtual visit with us. We're going on a virtual tour of the Amherstburg Freedom Museum. This organization was founded by Black community members to preserve heritage sites and local stories in Essex County. We also head to the Voices of Freedom Park in Niagara-on-the-Lake to hear the incredible Blackburns and Misha Burgess-Gorman, courtesy of Bravo Niagara. The film honors the life and legacy of the remarkable Wilma Morrison, who dedicated her time to preserve Black history in Niagara. We also hear from our dear friends at Uncle Tom's Cabin Historic Site in Dresden.
Hello and welcome to the Amherstburg Freedom Museum. We're located at 277 King Street in Amherstburg, and this museum is in existence because of the amazing work and dedication of our founders, Mac and Betty Simpson, along with amazing community builders in Amherstburg and the surrounding area. My name is Lorene, and I'm the assistant curator here at the museum, and I'm excited to give you a tour today. Hello, my name is Mary Catherine, and I'm the curator here at the Amherstburg Freedom Museum. Right now, we're standing inside the Nazare African Methodist Episcopal Church, which was also used as a terminal station for the Underground Railroad, one of many all across Canada. Slavery existed in Canada for over 200 years before it was abolished on August 1st of 1834. So that meant people were able to come and escape into Canada. They'd be considered free people once they arrived here. Amherstburg was seen as a really attractive place for people to cross over into Canada because it lies along one of the narrowest points of the Detroit River, and it's not directly across from a larger city like Sandwich in Windsor is across from Detroit. Unfortunately, we don't know how many people came across into Amherstburg during the whole of the Underground Railroad period, but there was anecdotal evidence that after 1855, there were about 30 people crossing into Amherstburg per day. And at one point, there were more Black people in Amherstburg than there were white people. Through the whole of the Underground Railroad, they estimate between 30 to 40,000 people came up through Canada. Unfortunately, we don't know exactly how many people came through Amherstburg, but we estimate there are quite a number of people that came through here in this region. Many people did end up staying here in Amherstburg and building their lives here, while others continued on their Underground Railroad journey onto other Black settlements in the region, such as the Buxton Settlement, which was known as the Elgin Settlement, and the Uncle Tom's Cabin site, which was at that time known as the Dawn Settlement. This church, as I mentioned, was built in 1848 and was established by Reverend Noah C.W. Cannon, and the congregation began after that point to congregate here in the stone building in 1848. There are many different ways that people would cross the river into Amherstburg. Some people, if they were lucky, they could get boated across by an abolitionist. So that's someone who was risking their lives and their livelihoods to help bring people across to freedom into Canada. Some people, they would maybe stow away in a ferry that was leaving from Ohio or Michigan, or even board as a passenger on those ferries and come to this region. And in most extreme cases, people did actually swim across the river, which would have been really dangerous to do so because of the rushing current. The river itself is not as deep as it is now, but it would have been really dangerous to cross because of that current. In the wintertime, people would also cross the frozen ice into Amherstburg, and some people would cross over onto Bablo Island first before coming into Amherstburg. When people made it across into Amherstburg, they would seek out places like the Nazare African Methodist Episcopal Church, which was a terminal station on the Underground Railroad, so the end of their Underground Railroad journey. So people would seek out these places for shelter, food, clothing, and whatever the congregation could provide for them. This church has a storied history of many uses, so it was almost like a community center where people could gather as a community, and also as it functioned as a school for a time being until one was opened just down the street as a segregated school in Amherstburg from 1850 to 1910. The church as we're standing it now represents a renovation that was done by the congregation in 1888. So they actually raised the roof about 6 feet from where it was originally, and they added a pressed tin roof as well. They added the choir loft as an addition to the back end of the church as well. Also added in the renovation were the Gothic style windows, as you'll see here in the church right now. They originally had a painted glass in them. Right now we have a historic reproduction glass. They also added the wainscoting around the perimeter of the room as well. As you'll see, some of the pews are missing. So the pews behind me, those were also added to the church in 1888. And the ones behind me have been refinished over time. The Taylor Cabin. It's named after George Taylor, and he was an African-American who escaped enslavement in Kentucky. He went on to fight in the Civil War and was given $100 for his service after he was honorably discharged. Now, he came to Canada in 1870, and he lived in this cabin as an elderly man, and he lived here with his daughter Emma, his son-in-law Thomas Thompson, and their daughter Azalea. Now, it's also important to share that Thomas Thompson, his son-in-law, was actually the very first Black person to own this cabin, so he also plays an important part of the story. Now, they would have lived here quite comfortably using artifacts like the ones that you're going to see in this cabin, and I'm going to point out a couple of them to you as well. Now, I should share that these artifacts were not owned by George and his family. These were actually donated by local Black families, which to me is just as significant because it really does help paint a picture of what life was like at the time. Now, one of the artifacts I want to share with you is this plow here. This plow was actually donated by the Hearst family, and the Hearst family is a pretty well-known family in Amherstburg. Wayne Hearst was actually the very first mayor of African descent in Amherstburg, and it was his father, Lorne, who donated it to the museum. Now, the plow was actually forged by their ancestor, George Thompson. He was previously enslaved and a blacksmith. And to me, having an artifact like this connected to your family is really significant. As someone who studies the local families in this area, a lot of times you'll find things like birth records and census records, a photograph if you're really lucky. But to find an artifact like this, I think is pretty significant because it's such an impressive piece that is connected to this family. Another artifact that I wanted to show you is right here. It's this birthing chair. Now, this birthing chair actually has names and dates of children who are born in the chair carved onto the chair, which I always love telling people about because it always gets this impressed expression once I tell them about it, because it literally has a person's written declaration of coming into this world written on the chair. So I think it's a pretty impressive piece. Now, there's another part of the cabin that I wanted to share, and it's just to my right here. This space is actually a cellar. We do get a lot of people asking us if it was used to hide people in the Underground Railroad, but it actually wasn't. We don't have any evidence of that. But what I will say, though, is that it does give us the opportunity to introduce the fact that people did come to Canada and weren't completely safe once they came here. There's a lot of myths that exist in Canadian history in terms of the Underground Railroad and Black Settlement, and that's one of them, that people were 100% safe once they came over here. That's not true at all. So this space here, it is actually an example of more modern history in terms of a cellar, but there were spaces in Essex County where people did actually hide. For example, if you go to our church, which you've actually done, you're going to see a space near the piano. We believe that there was a trap door there based on the information from previous curators, but we don't have the written evidence to prove that. But what I will say, though, is that it does fit the structural history because there is a basement below it, and also the fact that the museum was a terminus of the Underground Railroad and was so close to the waterfront, it certainly does make sense with the history. So again, this space here, it was used as a cellar, and we don't actually have evidence proving that it was used to hide people, but there were spaces in Essex County that did do that. Now, a little bit more about the current history of the museum. If you remember, there was a little girl, Azalea, that I mentioned. That's George Taylor's granddaughter. She actually lived in this cabin with her husband, William Wilson, and he lived here into the 1970s. Now, he updated the cabin to have more modern conveniences, like electricity. So if you look up, you'll see these double screw holes, and those actually are where the electrical wires were fed through. He also had vents for heating, and there was plaster on the walls too, but that was taken down with time. They wanted to make it look more original to the time period.
And by they, I mean the museum. There is also an upstairs to the cabin, which you're welcome to take a look at as well. There's some interesting artifacts that are up there. That space started out more as a small attic space, but it was built up to be more of a livable second story. And there's some interesting artifacts upstairs that you might want to take a look at. Back in the cabin, I had mentioned that there are many myths that exist in Canadian history in terms of Black history, and one of them is that slavery didn't exist in Canada. That is false. We had slavery here in Canada until 1834, and after 1834, once you touched Canadian soil, you were free. But before that, the opposite occurred. And one example of that is found in this display case here, and it talks about Matthew Elliott, who was an enslaver in Amherstburg, and his property is roughly 2 minutes away from the museum. And he owned roughly 60 enslaved persons. And one example that we really like to highlight in this case is this iron ring here. Now, this iron ring was actually embedded in a tree, and it was used to tie up an enslaved person and punish them, probably for not doing anything wrong at all. But this is a clear example of how we have to look to our own history in terms of slavery in Canada and not look to the United States to tell our own story.
This is the Watkins family trunk. It has been graciously loaned to us as a long-term loan by the Watkins family, and it has a very long and storied history about the origins of this trunk. According to family lore, the trunk was used by Alan Watkins to transport two of his children as they escaped through the Underground Railroad to freedom in Canada. Thank you for joining us in the tour of the Amherstburg Freedom Museum. We hope you've learned a little about Black history in Canada, and we'd love to have you come visit the museum and learn a lot more about Black history and why it's important. Thank you for visiting.
I'm Nicole Chambers, and I'm going to be singing I'm Fine. Yeah, yeah. I said that I'm fine. Don't ask me again. No, I'm not lying, and nobody's crying. Hold back my tears and grin. I said that I'm fine. Don't ask me again. Oh, forget what I said. It's temporary. I just needed to vent. I said that I'm fine. Don't ask me again. Just know that I'm happy. Cover, repeat, and blend it. yeah. I am not okay today, yeah, yeah. Oh, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. I know I said that I'm fine, but I'll admit it. I'm all sorts of messed up, even though I act up, but I can't help it. How do you break down walls when you're 20 feet tall? So instead, I tell myself that I'm okay. I don't address my emotions because they in the way. Yeah. Oh, 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 yeah, yeah. Do you really believe that? Oh, because it's okay not to be okay. Yeah, yeah. Oh,
I don't know. Thank you guys. Have a good one.
The Ontario Black History Society would like to thank all of you for attending our virtual Black History Month kickoff. I would like to express my sincere appreciation to the OBHS team. I am so proud to volunteer with such committed individuals. Our board members, staff, volunteers, and interns have all worked throughout the pandemic to help keep the Ontario Black History Society open and operating. A heartfelt thank you to you all. Thanks again to our lead sponsor, TD Bank, for their ongoing and generous support, for their integral role in making today's event a possibility. We also wanted to thank ETFO, our silver sponsor, and all of our virtual sponsors for this, their role this year. History is all-encompassing. It anchors us, especially during times like this. We are proud to continue our service to community with our virtual Black History Month kickoff event. We want to close with a newly released musical tribute to Black Canadian history produced by the Kitchener-Waterloo Multicultural Centre in partnership with the Congress of Black Women, Waterloo Region Chapter, and the Canadian Caribbean Association. Hymn to Freedom pays homage to the extensive history of Black people in Canada and honors the amazing Black Canadian jazz musician, Oscar Peterson. We invite you to share this video during your own Black History Month and in your classrooms as we continue to commemorate this important time of year. The Ontario Black History Society wishes you well. Please stay safe and stay healthy.
to